Welcome to this video on how do I create PowerShell scripts for Microsoft Dynamics NAV 2013 R2. I'm Waldo and I'm a Dynamics NAV MVP and I'm creating this video in collaboration with Platan. At the end of this video, we will have built a commandlet ourselves. And this commandlet will execute a certain code unit in all the companies of all the tenants of all the service instances you want. So the objective of this video is certainly tell you a little bit more about scripting, which means I will tell you how to use variables, conditions, and looping, and how to create your own commandlets, which basically means how to create functions, how to use parameters in these functions, and how to be able to pipe into these commandlets that you have built. And we're going to do that in four easy steps. First of all, I will tell you something more about variables and looping. Next, we will go into the conditions and how to display messages. Next, we will create a function with parameters and tell you how that goes. And we conclude with building our own commandlet, which will execute a code unit where you want. Let me tell you a little bit more first about how to use variables and how to do looping in scripts. Now to do this, I will use the same examples that I created in the video, how do I backup and restore in a multi-tenant environment. I created two scripts there, one to backup and one to restore. And I will take the example of the backup to walk you through the use of variables and looping. Now, as you can see, all the text in orange is actually the assignment and the use of variables. Now, on top of this script, we are assigning a certain string, which is actually our server instance, and we are assigning that to a variable. A variable always starts with a dollar sign. The nice thing is I can use that in this session of PowerShell and it will remember the variables in the session. So I'm assigning that and I can just use that now. The variable is in my IntelliSense, as you can see, and I can just check what is in there, and indeed the Dynamics NAV 7.1 is in there. Now this is a very simple kind of assignment. I can also put the output of an entire commandlet in there, which actually means that I'm putting an object into a variable. This is exactly what I'm doing when I'm preparing my backup of my application database. So on this place, what I'm doing here is I'm executing the commandlet get nav application. I'm using my variable that I just assigned, and I'm putting the output into a new variable, being the nav application. So let me do that. Now I can use that nav application, and let me check what is in there. And there is more than just text in there. There is actually an object in there, an object with two properties, the database server and the database name. And this being an object, I can access these two properties separately. So let me do that. So this NAV application dot. And here I've got all the things I can do with my object. And I've got my database name and database server here as well. So if I, for instance, want to use my database name, let me print that. It's going to print only that. Now, this was one object with properties. But I know that, for instance, the output of the getNav tenant for this service instance is going to give me a lot of tenants, like here they are. Now let's put that into a variable and see what we can do with that. Now for the nav tenants, I don't have real properties. Actually, this is a collection of objects, and as a collection contains a lot of objects, I just can count the objects. I know that there are 12 tenants in my collection of objects. For my script, I will have to loop my tenants. And for this, we have the for each loop. So what we can say is for each tenant in my collection nav tenants, do something. And in this case, doing something is just showing the ID of the tenant. So if I execute this, you'll see that it's going to loop the tenants collection one by one, and it's going to print the ID one by one. This basically covers what we need to know on variables and looping to do some basic scripting on NAV. Now let's drill into some if-then-else loops and how to do some messaging while running a script. And we'll do that also based on the script that we used in the how do I backup and restore in a multi-tenant environment. Namely, we used a slightly modified script for the restore part. Now this is the script, and as you can see, it's slightly modified. We've got the automatic mounting of the application and also mounting of the tenants incorporated in this script as well. Now, sometimes it makes sense to display to the user where you are in the script or what the script is doing at that moment. And you can do that just by displaying messages on the console or in the verbose message stream. And we've got two commandlets for that, which is the write to host. And this is going to display a message to the console window, like hello world. It's going to just display hello world. It's actually just quite the same as just do this. And there is also the write verbose. And this is actually going to put that in the verbose message window. So if you would access your script or commandlet in a verbose kind of message stream, then it would put it there. Now in the script on top, you can see that I used this a couple of times. So the script is going to first set some parameters, like I'm going to restore all backup files in this folder. Next, I'm displaying, okay, now I'm going to make my service multi-tenant. And here you go. Then I'm going to display, okay, now I'm going to dismount all tenants. And here you go. And then we go further and we're coming into a loop, like, okay, I'm looping now all the backup files in my folder. And for each file, I need to restore. I'm setting all my parameters and here I'm going to restore it. And before I'm starting to restore it again, I'm going to message to the user, like, I'm going to restore this backup file with this name to this database. And after that, I'm going to mount it. And if it is an app database, I'm going to again write to the user the messages that I would like to write. So in this way, you can tell the user where the script is at that moment. In this script, you'll find also some conditions. When I'm actually restoring all the databases, I've got two types of databases. Either I'm restoring an application database or a tenant database. Like you see here, I've got one app database and four tenant databases. And I have to do different things for these databases. In these conditions, I evaluate the name. And if it starts with app, I know it's an app database and I'm going to remove app from the name. And if it's a tenant, I know it's a tenant database, and I'm going to remove the tenant from the name. Now, further on, I need the same condition to be able to know whether I have to mount a NAV application and use that commandlet, or I have to mount a NAV tenant and use the corresponding commandlet. Now, let us execute the script and see what happens. You can immediately see the messages that I created in the script to show me where the script is at that moment. So I know it's now making my service multi-tenant. Now it's dismounting all the existing tenants and so on and so on. So far for the introduction in using conditions and messaging. What we have been doing until now is actually just putting a lot of statements after each other. But what we didn't do yet is create a reusable generic function that we can reuse all the time. So what I'll do first now is just tell you how to create a function before we'll create our own commandlet. When creating your own reusable generic function, the first thing you do is give it a name. So let's declare a function called Waldo test function, and I'm going to put some business logic in it. Like I'm writing to the console, write host, hello world. Now, when I don't execute this, you'll see that Waldo.text function is not recognized by the console. But when I execute this, from this moment, I can use the function. And Waldo.text function is actually part of my session. Now, obviously, I can use some parameters as well, and the simplest way for doing that is just put it behind. Like, I expect some kind of test, and I'm going to put that behind. By default, it is just not a mandatory parameter. Let's execute this. When I just execute it without it, you'll see that I don't need to fill in, and it's just going to execute the business logic still. But when I provide the parameter, is going to put that behind the hello world. Unfortunately, it's not going to be as simple as this. When I create a function, it usually looks something like this. And the first thing you see is the commandlet binding. This keyword lets my function behave as being a real commandlet. Next is the parameter section, where I'm going to provide some more properties of my parameter. First of all, the two properties, service instance and ID, are mandatory. I cannot run my function without these properties. And the next one is kind of interesting, is the value from pipeline by property name, which actually means if I'm piping a command into this function, you can copy the value of the properties which have the same property names. The next section is actually the begin and the process section. And the difference between these are is the begin is only executed once, and the process is executed for all the objects that are piped into this commandlet. Let's just execute this and see what we mean with that. If I use the while the test function without the parameter, which are actually mandatory, it's just going to ask me the parameters, like test and test ID. And you'll see that the text in the begin section is executed. It's just saying begin. And on the process section, it's going to also execute that once. Now, as I said, I can pipe stuff into this function. So let me take the next example. I can do get nav server instance and pipe that into the get nav tenant. This is actually done a lot of times. And this gives me all the tenants of the service instances that are on my server. If I just count them, you see that I've got 12 of these tenants. Now I can pipe this into the while the test function. And you'll see that again, the begin section is only executed once. I get only one message saying begin, but for every tenant, I get a message in the process providing me the service instance and the ID. So now that we are able to create our own functions with parameters, let's use that knowledge and create our own commandlet. The commandlet that we will create will be based on the invoke nav code unit commandlet that we get from Microsoft. To show you what it should be able to do, I will just show you what the outcome is. Now, first of all, I have created the code unit 50,000, and let me look at it. In this code unit, I actually have some triggers, like first of all, the default on run trigger, which is going to display a message like this is the on run trigger. Now, I also have some messages like the throw error, the show message, and so on. Now, I would like to run this code unit, which is going to give back a message with the current session, the tenant ID, and the company name, so that I know in which tenant and company the code unit is running at that moment. I want to do it in this way. For all my server instances, get me all the tenants, and for all these tenants, invoke that code unit. I called it invoke code nav code unit 2, as invoke nav code unit already existed, and invoke that code unit 50,000. And I'm getting all the messages of that on run trigger. Also just showing a message or running a different function within that code unit should be possible as well. Now next, it should be possible to get some help as well, like get help nav code unit 2, which is giving me the help. This is the function that I created, which obviously starts with the name of the function. And then, which I didn't show you yet, a part of documentation that will be accessed when you access the get help. Next, you see obviously again the commandlet binding and the parameter definition. The first two parameter definitions are actually quite the same as the while the test function that we showed earlier. But next, I need some more parameters as well. Like I need a code unit ID, which code unit I need to execute, but also which method and maybe which argument that I have to send to that method. And the next part is for my business logic. Now notice that I don't loop tenants and I don't loop service instances. In fact, I expect the service instance and the tenant as being piped into this function. And the only loop that I have to provide is looping the companies from the tenant. I know that I put this business logic in the process part that it's going to loop my tenants automatically. It's actually going to execute the process part for each tenant that is piped into it. So that's what I'm doing. I'm actually just getting all the NAV companies and putting that into a variable. And then I'm going to loop this variable, actually just loop these companies, and I'm going to execute the default invoke NAV code unit. This code unit is going to display a message, and it's that message that is showed here in the console window. Now this concludes my four steps. I've showed you how to create variables, do some looping, create conditions, and all this in scripts. And I also showed you how to create functions and even let these functions behave the same as commandlets. So I hope you enjoyed this video and you will start creating your own scripts. Thank you for listening and see you next time.